thank you for joining me for this third and final installment of the faldilline or wrap skirt construction video. So in this video, the most important thing to remember is to keep your stitches even and regular. We're in the final stretch. We are sewing the facing in, we're sewing the stiffener in. We are sewing the decorative trim on the outside all around the edges, and then we're binding the waist. And as we do this work, it's important to keep an eye on all the edges of the fabric, keep your body relaxed, and make sure that you are really focusing and being present with the stitches that you're making. It's so easy to get distracted by things around you and not pay attention to the evenness or regularity of your stitches, and that really does show in the final garment when you're doing everything by hand. It really makes a big difference to continually pause, take a deep breath, and remember what your hands are supposed to do. So the first thing we're going to look at is the hem stiffener. We'll get sewn around the perimeter, and then we will move to the outside of the garment, and we'll begin sewing the wide bias for the decorative trim, followed by the binding around the exterior edge, and finally the waist edge. So get your needles ready, and let's get to sewing. In this step, we are beginning the application of the stiffener. And the stiffener goes down one of the back edges, all the way around the bottom, and up the other back edge. So the entire exterior is stiffened with this fabric. It's very simple. There is no rocket science to it whatsoever. You just lay the edges together, and very close to the edge, you just start taking some long stitches. I'm doing this in a matching color thread, but they are essentially basting stitches. They don't have to be particularly small because there is a binding that is going along this exterior edge eventually, and it's going to make everything even more secure. So you don't have to fight for super tiny stitches in this instance. We are about to turn the corner with this facing. This piece of fabric is, you know, the wool itself is 60 inches wide, so we have more than enough length for a bata and a quarter. So as I reach the edge, I'm gonna give it a little bit of a clip, and that enables the wool to spread open just a little bit as I turn the corner, and then I'll go through and trim this excess away and actually miter the corner of the wool, but only after I've done the majority of the application. So, turning, I'm going to take a little back stitch just to give it some extra security. And then I'll keep on with my basting around the hem. Now, if you notice, like around the hem, we have a nice round curve. So, just know that the exterior edge that we're stitching on first is the larger of the two edges, which means we'll really have to use the iron to shrink down the inner curve that's going around the hem. It sounds really complicated. It's not. You just get it hot and damp with a little bit of steam, and the wool should just shrink up without even the tiniest pucker, depending on the quality of the wool that you're using, of course. If you are stiffening the edge with linen, if, for example, you're making this garment out of silk, if you stiffen with linen, then you might have to put a couple of clips in the linen to close the inner curved edge. We are approaching the end of this piece of wool, and we'll have to start a fresh one. And I'll just keep stitching here without cutting the video so that you can see what needs to happen. We are moving along, and we'll overlap the old one and the new one by about an inch or so, and we'll just keep going. We don't even have to stitch them together, make a seam, nothing. They're just overlapped, and you keep moving on. Since it's not structural, other than the stiffness that it's providing,
we don't really have to have a big fight with the fabric about perfect finishing. It's on the inside, it's serving its function. We don't need to go into a place of overkill with the work. So I'm just overlapping by about an inch. I'm making sure as I cross from one to the other, I'm getting all the way through both layers to the outside so that they're very well secured at the edge. And then I just keep going. We're at the iron now, and we are going to shrink the outer or the inner edge of the stiffener. And you can see that it's fluting just a little bit right here, and that's because it's on a curve, and that inner edge needs to be smaller than the outer edge. So our iron is nice and hot and good and steamy. I'm going to start by puffing steam onto this and getting it good and hot and damp. And then I'm just going to lay the iron on top. And the wool should just shrink in all on its own. You see how it's laying almost perfectly flat now? That is the beauty of using steam and heat on a good thick piece of wool. I'm going to ship this over now, and I'll do that again, because we have a whole hem that has to be taken care of. Same thing, steam, get it good and hot. If you're doing this with period techniques, you'll want to make sure that you actually brush water onto this wool before the iron gets put down upon it. Typically, in a historical setup, you would have had a bowl of water and a paintbrush, and you would have just painted water, like just brushed water right onto the surface. And as the very hot iron comes off of the coals on a brazier, it's the steam would just immediately vaporize, and or the water would immediately vaporize, and the steam would start shrinking the wool right there. But you just keep working it like this. See how I'm gently lifting the iron and pressing those curves, and it flattens out all along this edge. Our facing has been basted around the exterior edge. We're about to start basting the interior edge. But before I do, I want to trim away the excess here for the miter. So when I pressed this, I just pressed right up to where the diagonal was. I pressed this one. And then we just end up with this little triangle sticking straight up. So I'm going to lay the scissors flat to the fabric and just cut that triangle off. And you can see that it just magically makes exactly the right join. So when I'm coming across with my basting, I'll pause at this point and whip the wool together to close it, catching ever so slightly the threads from the foundation fabric. Begin at the top, and as I'm working, I'm smoothing everything carefully with my thumb and forefinger underneath so that I'm making sure that I keep it smooth, and I'm catching just as the smallest amount of the exterior fabric that I possibly can, because I don't really want these stitches to show through. It's sort of unavoidable, but it will be masked once the decorative trim goes on. The decorative trim will be going right against this inner edge of the facing, but on the outside. So any stitches which might possibly show through, which these are barely causing divots on the outside, any stitches which might show through will be masked by the silk trim. We are approaching the miter. So I'm still finishing up this interior edge going down one of the backs, one of the back edges. So now I'm here, and I'm just going to carry my needle underneath over to the other side. It's still on top of the exterior fabric. And then I'm going to just whip this closed. And about every second or third stitch, let's say every third stitch, I'm actually going to catch some threads. You can see I'm actually catching some of the threads of the exterior wool. And that helps to keep this miter in place and keep the corner nice and firm. Otherwise, there might be a tendency for the exterior fabric to bubble slightly at a corner like this, especially after additional layers of trim go on. I won't worry about going into the exterior fabric, but then I'll just whip my way back the other direction, right on top of the stitches that I just made and through those wool layers. So it'll be very secure, and then it'll get nice and flat when I press it after this step is done. One of the things that you'll notice is the position, one of the things I'd like you to notice is the position in which I'm holding this fabric. The majority of the garment is towards me in the lap. The open edge of the piece is away from me, so that when I'm working, I'm holding the open edge up instead of trying to work this direction with the open edge towards you. You have no fabric here to hold on to. There's nothing to brace against your leg as you're working, and it has a tendency to shift and cause a lot of problems. So holding it with the main body towards you, the open edge away, you now have something firm against which to plant a body part so that you can hold on to your piece as you're working. Very important technique. Stitched everything around the perimeter very flat and even, and now we're stitching along the interior curve, so we have to make sure that we ease it in just a little bit. I used plenty of steam when I was at the iron to ease it in a little bit, to shrink the top edge so that it will go in more easily. However, it's not 100% effective because this is a very thick fabric and the iron doesn't always do a complete job of shrinking the wool down. So I just want to be extra sure that we're not getting any shifting on the outside. So I'm using my thumb to push just a little tiny bubble of the wool in with each stitch. Okay. This gives us a really good solid hem stiffening. If I was very virtuous in the construction of this skirt, I could also add an extra layer of silk on the inside here to cover this wool facing, although I don't really think that's particularly necessary because this is an undergarment. So I'll just finish up this stitching here and we can move on to applying the guard to the outside of the garment. As I'm taking each stitch, I've got my index finger of my left hand underneath the work. I'm taking a very small pick on the outside, which in the next step will become the guideline for stitching the guard onto the hem of the skirt. So it's okay that I'm going through to the outside. It will eventually get covered by the silk that is going to be our little band. Here we are at the ironing board. We are about to press the wide bias into a width that we can use to apply to this skirt. This is the guard. Now we have some options as far as width is concerned. We can go fully doubled, which gives us a narrow, maybe it will probably finish out at just like about 4 centimeters, just under 2 inches. That's if we fold it completely in half, and we can make it a little bit wider by shifting this top layer back however far we need to. The complication is that we stitch the bottom of it first, and then we stitch the folded edge second. And the wider we make the trim, the more the folded edge has to be shrunk down in order to make it lay properly. So what we really don't want is to have it terribly puckered. So I tend to go a little bit narrower with this, but I'm gonna fold it here, and I'm leaving just about a centimeter on the far edge. Let me just press that. Oh, I got a little bit of watermark. So you can see I've got just a little bit of allowance right there. And what I'll do is I'll line this cut edge up with the stitches that went through to the surface on the stiffener. And then I'll stitch right along the edge here, right along this edge right here. And that way I will know that it's nice and even. So I have to press this whole strip, and it's quite long. I'm not going to make you watch all of it. All right, here I have one of the center back edges of this garment. So this is one of the straight sides. So the first thing I'll do is I'll lay the silk in place, and you can see this little line of divots right here. That is what I'll be following for the edge of the silk. And I'm just going to use a running stitch because this is a non-stress bearing seam. And I just need to get the silk in place. I'm leaving a little bit hanging here off the end because I have a triangular cut, which is typical when you're cutting bias. And I don't want to fold this over and then not have enough fabric. For stitching this, I am using the same heavy silk thread that I used to apply the stiffener on the inside. And I'm just doing a running stitch. So about 1/4 inch from the edge, I've begun to just push my needle in and out of the fabric, like so. You can see. And I only will do 3 or 4 stitches at a time because I'm working through the silk and 2 layers of the wool. That means that it's quite thick, and I will need to fight all of that thickness as I stitch. Now, these stitches aren't necessarily going all the way through to the inside either. I really only need to just go into the surface of the stiffener inside. I don't have to penetrate all the way through to the back, because if I try to, then I'll end up taking stitches that are too big and too deep, and it'll start to quilt the layers together rather than just apply the silk on. Now, there's nothing wrong with quilting the layers together necessarily, but it's energy that I don't need to necessarily expend just to be able to get the face or the guard sewn on. I know that many of you will probably say, oh, how many stitches per inch? Which is a common question that I get. However, I really don't pay attention to such things. I do in my head say, oh, stitches here might want to be a little smaller, but in reality, oops, got tangled up, sorry. As long as it's in place and it's secure, that's what matters. So as I work, I'm making sure that the cut edge stays aligned with the divots from the stitching of the stiffener. And that is my guide. If it's hard for you to see, you can chalk along that line so you have something that's a little bit easier to see. you'll notice that I will take 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 running stitches, and then I'll do a short draw, and then I'll do 4 or 5 more running stitches, and then a full draw of the thread. And this is just to speed things along. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, short draw, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I guess technically it's 6 because my needle has to come back out, and then a long draw. And then after about, I don't know, 10 inches, 25 centimeters, I will take an extra back stitch, and that helps to just secure everything in place so that in case any of these stitches should ever pop free, the whole thing doesn't come running off. It'll stop where the back stitch is and keep it secure.
In this area, we are about to turn the corner. And to do that, we sort of line this up with our edge, and then we clip almost all the way through. And what this will do is it frees the outer edge of this silk to enable us to do a tighter corner. Otherwise, we'll have to fiddle with it and it won't work well. So we cut all the way in, we turn, and we line up along the new edge, keeping our cut nice and open and the silk nice and tight, and we begin stitching again. And I'll take a couple of small back stitches just to make sure that it's secure, and we'll keep going.
So we are beginning our work on the outer edge of the finished guard. So when it's turned up like this, then we have upper edge, lower edge. So we're starting by stitching our lower edge. And what that means is that we have to stretch the bias a little bit as it goes on. If we don't, so how I'm holding it is I've got these two fingers underneath here, and these two fingers up here. If we don't stretch it a little bit, what'll end up happening is that the upper edge will have too much fabric in it and we'll end up getting puckers. We really want this to lay nice and smooth. So we're going to stretch the bottom just a little bit, because once we press this, it will relax out into the appropriate shape. But while we're stitching it on, we need to make sure that we've accommodated that. So I'm just giving it a little bit of a stretch. Not tons. I mean, really, you can't go too far with it anyway. The top edge is still being aligned with the little divots that it's hard to see in the camera, but the little divots that came from stitching the hem stiffener in place are visible. So I'm aligning the cut edge of the bias with that, and then taking my stitches. And I'm not going super deep. I don't really need to go all the way through to the inside. I'm just catching the wool and going a little bit into the stiffener. And after every, you know, couple of inches, I think this is about 3 inches, I take an extra back stitch. And that helps to keep everything nice and secure so that should any stitch break, which it really, there's not a lot of opportunities for a stitch to break on a decorative band like this. But should a stitch ever break, it won't come undone the whole way around. It'll just unstitch a few inches and then stop.
Okay, Here we are about to begin stitching the upper edge of the decorative band. And it's quite simple. You just turn it up, keep it nice and flat, and begin the stitching. And the stitching is done with a felling stitch. Now with a felling stitch, you come up through the fabric, catching just a little bit of the edge, as we see right here, and then the needle goes in just behind where the thread came out, but in the fashion fabric, and then it comes up through the fold of the silk. So you can see the needle goes in, comes out. And this is one of those stitches where you can take two or three at a time and then do a good long draw. So you take two or three short ones and then a long draw. And you just keep going. It's about an eighth of an inch per stitch, I think, as far as distance goes. Although, again, I really don't pay a whole lot of attention. I just do what feels right for the context of it. You can do the same. So just repeat this throughout. One of your main goals should be every time you shift the fabric to move down after a few stitches, you want to make sure that you're smoothing this bias nicely into place. If you don't, it has a tendency to shift and it'll appear twisted a little bit and you'll get all of these diagonal wrinkles across the surface of the silk. If you're using wool for this, it actually is a little bit more forgiving. And this is just right now in this shot, we're just going down the back.
So I am approaching the miter of this decorative trim. So you can see that I've got this top layer that's just turned up. I'm going to stitch all the way to the end of it. And then I'm also conveniently running out of thread, so I'll re-thread. And then I'll turn up the adjoining or the adjacent edge and continue stitching. Right, secure with two stitches in one place, clip, rethread. So I secured my thread down here at the corner. I'll fold this up. And then I will stitch my way up to the interior corner and then proceed along that edge around the hem. When I take these stitches, I'm actually, let me zoom in here. You can see that I'm taking a little bit of fabric on this side and I'm actually tunneling through the fabric on this side. So it's slightly different from the felling stitch that I'm using to secure the rest of the trim down. In this instance, I'm trying to keep the thread as invisible as possible. So you can see when a stitch like that is taken, it almost can't be seen. So the needle will go into the fabric here, advance about an eighth of an inch. I'll pull it out and draw so that you can see. And then I will insert the needle into the fold of the upper layer and advance approximately the same amount and then draw. And as I do this, sort of dodging back and forth between these two layers, I create a nice little seam that structurally is very similar to just a running stitch, except that it's worked from the outside. And this is just so that I don't have, you know, a disturbing line of relatively light colored stitches super visible at this corner. I mean, that I don't know why it doesn't bother me along this edge here, but it would bother me along the miter. Call me crazy. You can also take these tips and make your own choices. So I've made it to the interior corner. Now I will take one extra stitch right there. And then I'll proceed with my felling stitch around the edge. Now, if you're really excited about this more invisible stitch, look, you can even do it along here. So to do it on along the top edge of the trim, I'll take a small pick of the wool, and then right where that thread comes out, I'll insert the needle through the fold of the silk, like so, and pull that, wash, rinse, repeat. Pardon me. Do that over and over again. And it just makes the stitches that much more innocuous, so that it looks like the trim just magically appears on the fabric as though it's not even stitched. See? Looks nice and clean. Now you have a few different options of how to apply this trim. Make your choice and go with it. This is what it looks like on the inside so far. So we have our hem stiffener here, and this is the line that's holding the hem stiffener in place, but then there's also a second line which you can't see very well. That is the first pass of the stitching holding the trim in place. And then these light colored stitches that you see right here, that is all of the stitches that are holding the upper edge of the trim in place. And you can see they're all nice and small and regular. That's, you know, the goal, except for that one. I missed that one. But as a beginner, your stitches may or may not be that even. But as long as they're doing the job of holding the trim in place and the trim looks good, you're golden. And we're done. Our next task is to prepare the binding to go on, and that's actually quite easy. Here is our binding. You can see that I've trimmed and pressed the allowance. See, there's our little hand stitching line in there. So this one's very simple in that you just take this strip of bias and you just press it in half, completely in half. And that makes the silk double layered, it makes it nice and sturdy, and it will make it very easy to handle as you're stitching it on. Here is the inside of one of the center backs of the skirt. And I'm looking at the facing, which is already stitched in place. But I'm going to put the binding here on the inside. Now I'll be doing this first pass with a dark colored thread. And that's just because if for so, it shouldn't be a problem in this piece, but on the off chance that my stitches go very deep and they're visible on the other side, they'll be pretty innocuous. So I'm threading up a relatively small needle. Well, small in comparison to what I typically use. This is about a size 5, as opposed to a size 3 or 4, which is what I generally will stitch wool with. And I'm going to begin by stitching at 1/4 inch. This is not a stress-bearing seam, so I don't need to use anything stronger than a running stitch. I'm not going all the way through the fabrics either. This is a very thick portion of the skirt. So really all I care about is just that this side of the silk gets nice and secure. And you can see that it looks pretty good. So we have the inside here and you can see what that seam looks like. Then once that whole thing is done, then we'll come to the outside. And this will fold in place this way, and then it'll be hemmed right along that fold. But I got the raw edges here, and I'm doing my running stitch here, so the fold is over here, which means that it's all ready for us to stitch down. As I approach the corner with the binding, I want to make sure that I can miter it attractively. So I am almost to the 1/4 inch mark away from the bottom edge. I've got all of these stitches right here. I'm going to back stitch my way up to where the folds intersect, which is right here. I'm going to plunge the needle through to the back. I'm going to flip the triangle up. And I'm going to bring the needle back up where I need to go. And then I'm going to take a back stitch here and another. And then I'll turn my work so that I can continue to work along this edge. When you look at this fold here, you can see that all I have to do is just lay the crease one direction, flip it up, and it is mitered. Then once it's folded to the other side, I can miter again by virtue of folding one side in and then the second. And it'll create the miter. The next step is to secure the binding in place. So I have my matching color thread, and when I say matching, I mean matching the color of the binding rather than the main textile. So I have the folded edge peeking out here, and I'm just going to turn it down over all of the stitching on the main body of the garment. And then I'm going to fell it in place. And this will continue around the entire perimeter of the skirt. We're stitching the binding in place and we are approaching the corner. So I want to show you how to miter the corner on the outside. We already did it on the inside when we turned the corner with the binding. We prepared it for a mitered finish. So here on the inside, we made our little pleat as we turned the corner, and that gave us a little miter on the inside. So now, as we are finishing the outside, I'm going to stitch right up to the corner here. I'm going to take one extra stitch for security, and then I'm going to fold this binding up into place and take a stitch through this corner that has been set on top, and that secures it. And then once we, oh goodness, then when we go and press this afterwards, this nice crisp little mitered corner will become even more clean and tidy. So the idea is that we prepared for this in our previous step with the way that we turned the corner with our binding, and now we are reaping the benefits of that preparation. The interesting thing about working things by hand like this is that you really have to pay attention to what the next 4 or 5 steps are in order to be able to think ahead and make sure that the step you're doing isn't going to interfere with the next step, or better yet, that the step you're working on is done in such a way that it prepares the entire garment for the next step so that everything works together in harmony. Here we have the skirt almost ready for the waistband finishing. I've done a bit of embroidery on the left back, which is the one that usually is dressed on top. So frequently you'll see in modern interpretations of Spanish historic dress, like traditional dress, you'll see the left back is decorated and embroidered because that's the one that everyone sees. And in traditional dress, this is actually worn as an outer skirt, so all the better. Now we're creating these as undergarments, so the embroidery is less essential, but I will be showing this skirt to a lot of people over in the next coming years, and I really wanted something that was beautifully decorated. So there's the waist area, which we're going to be working on next. All right. It's an awful lot of stitching. I hope you guys have had great practice. Here we can see, this is the waist edge. These are the two center backs. I'm just going to trim away the excess right here so that we have a nice clean line to stitch against. I've got them both layered together just because it's faster and cleaner. That way we know they're both exactly the same. I'm going to throw away my excess here. And then I have my waistband. Now, the waistband should be about 4 times the actual waist measurement. So that would be 4 bara. That would be a waist bara. And that is just shy of basically 2 full fabric widths of this linen. You can use scraps of the silk if you want to, as long as they're on the straight grain. I ran out of silk. So I don't have anything that's going to match these stripes here, so I'm just using these pieces of linen. It's underwear, it's not a huge issue, and I feel like the linen will actually be more durable against the abrasion when it's worn. So I'm going to piece these two together, and then I'm going to press them in half this way, and then we're going to finish the waist and treat it exactly the same way that we treated the binding that went around the perimeter. The only difference is that we're going to take the center seam, which is going to be on a selvage here. We're going to take the center seam and match it up with center front so that we have 2 very long tails that hang off of the end of each back. I am ready to stitch the ends of this waist tape. And this is going to be the center front of the waistband. What I want to do though is this needs to be stitched very strong and with very small stitches because it will carry a lot of stress. The skirt will be pulled tight. This is a load-bearing seam, so to speak. I'm stitching very carefully with heavy silk thread in a very small back stitch. These stitches aren't even a full eighth of an inch apart. I would say they're 3/32 of an inch long. And I'm using green silk thread for two reasons. One, so that it's easy for you to see on video, and two, because it is the closest color that I have to the beige. In order to keep this nice and secure and make sure that it lasts a very long time, instead of pressing this seam allowance open, I'm actually going to lay it over to the whole allowance, both sides, lay it over to one side, and then top stitch it very thoroughly for strength. And I'm opening this up. You can see how very tight and tiny all of those stitches are. This seam won't be coming out anytime soon. But just to be sure, I'm top stitching it. And I'm actually using a back stitch for a top stitch, about an eighth of an inch away from the edge. This kind of back stitching used as top stitch is actually surprisingly more common than we used to think. It is frequently seen around the edges of doublets, particularly those that need to wear a little harder. But it looks remarkably similar to the top stitching that's used on jeans seams in modern clothes. That's that seam right there. It's done. I'm going to go to the iron. I'm going to trim away some of the bulk of the selvage because it's a little bit thicker. It's a little bit thicker here than I want it to be. So I'm going to trim that away so that it's a little softer. Because this is center front and because it's double folded, I want to be sure to reduce bulk where I can without compromising strength. Here we are at the iron. Here's my center front of the waistband. It's been top stitched. Just going to give it a nice solid press. Then I'm going to flip this over and take this seam allowance and just trim it down because it's too heavy and too thick and I don't need so much of it. Okay. Then once that's trimmed, they'll give another quick press. Now, I will just take this and fold it in half all the way down its length. So way back at the beginning of this project, I put a little notch at center front. This is a perfect example of where I need to know where center front is. So there's center front. Here is the seam in my waistband. This is actually on the inside of the garment that I'm working, and I'm lining up the centers here. Now this waistband seam, in contrast to what we did for the bindings around the perimeter, this one is going to be backstitched, and that's simply because we really don't want the waist to lose shape over time. We want the stitching to be very strong because this little thin band that we're stitching on is going to be supporting the entire weight of this skirt and supporting it against the pull of gravity and movement. So it needs to be very strong. So we'll backstitch it. These stitches are about an eighth of an inch long, and it's just, that's the size that the fabric is telling me to stitch. Like I can feel the layers working against my needle, and that's just how long they need to be. So I will continue to stitch this, and then the final step is actually just like the binding in that it's folded to the outside and then hemmed carefully in place with a felling stitch. Once that's done, then you can finish stitching the ends, the tails that become the ties. You can finish stitching those, and then this skirt is done and will be ready for a good press and for happy wearing. Here we are with this first seam done. Now, I began at center front and I backstitched my way all the way to the end where the rest of this tie is just dangling off. It's nice and long so that it makes it easy to wrap around and tie. But I need to do the other half of the skirt, so I'll flip this over and I'll stitch from this side and do center front to all the way around to the back end. And running right into my previous stitches, I will begin. The entire waistband is now attached all the way from center back to center back, and we're going to begin the stitching, the final pass of stitching. So you can see that once the waistband is folded, it's being folded in thirds. So we'll need to know that when we go to stitch the ties. But for now, we're going to begin stitching the waistband. Now, the stitching is exactly the same as the binding, which is folding this down and felling it in place. And again, because these stitches are visible on the outside, I'm going to make an effort to keep them very nice and even. I have chosen to use a thread that matches the main body of the skirt rather than matching the binding, but you can use whichever color you're more comfortable with. It doesn't make much of a difference as long as it's strong. I am ready to start stitching the ties in place. So at the very end here, you can see that we have a tri-fold. This is folded into thirds. So I'm going to continue with the folding into thirds. I have my needle threaded up with white linen thread that should blend in pretty innocuously with the linen, with the linen fabric. Now, I stitched the original waistband seams and hemming with silk so that it's nice and strong. But here, the tie itself will be taking all the stress, so I'm not particularly worried about whether this thread is strong enough. I think the tie itself will be perfectly strong enough. The ties are stitched. Now we're just going to give them press along with the waistband so that we have nice crisp edge to work with. The skirt's done. Let's have a look at it, shall we?
Here's the inside. Look how big that waist is. And this is for a relatively small mannequin. So don't worry if you're working on this and the waist seems unusually large. It's supposed to be 1.5 times your natural waist measurement. So here is the left back. And that's the right side of the garment. It has a nice drape, it has a good weight. So let's put this on the mannequin. Now, the easiest way to do this is when you're dressing it yourself, you just put it on, you match the center front up to yourself, and then wrap. If you're dressing someone else, it might be a little bit more complicated. Match that. I bring the underlap side around, and then the overlap side comes to the right hip, and then it gets tied. Make sure the layers underneath are lying smoothly. And you can see how great the shape is on this. It's got a beautiful line. And as we turn it around, you can see this decoration down her right side seam. Now, according to what I've seen in photographs, Spanish women wearing this type of skirt as part of their traditional costume put this decorated panel at center back, like the opening should be back here. I don't know how much they traditionally have the overlap on today's skirts. These are the proportions of the original from the manuals, which may be different than what they do in the modern world. So this will end up on the right hip. However, there's nothing that says you can't spin the skirt so that this goes down center back like a traditional skirt. The difference will be that your left hip will have 2 layers and your right hip will only have 1. But I love the way this skirt drapes. The circular nature of it really gives these good folds, and yet it's very flat. There's nothing really at the waist at all. It's so thin that it's not going to disturb any outer layers, and yet you get this extra volume at the bottom for whatever garment's going to go on top. Thank you so much for joining me here in the Modern Maker Workroom. My name is Matthew Nagy. Happy stitching, and wear it in good health.